So we are going to cover truss, which is often, you know, applied mostly applied in civil infrastructures. And as you see, both of us are, you know, from civil engineering department. So now we are going to keep this session very short. So you have basically morning session. I am going to cover the truss. And truss will include method of joints, method of sections, and also some other type of truss problems will also be solved. In addition to that, we are also going to look at stability and instability of a truss. That means when the truss is properly constrained and not properly constrained. So with that, we will have the 1.5 hour, let's say, lecture, and then we will continue to do the tutorial problems. So now, see, as you see truss, you know, almost everywhere, in roads, in bridges, you know, in footover bridge, and truss has been used. Now, why do we use a truss? Now, to summarize, I would say that to design a truss, first of all, is very simple. And also notice that all the truss members that we have, they are very slender in nature. So in that way, what we can do, we can actually make it more economical. So there are two aspects to it. One is the simple analysis, that is what we are going to learn, as well as also we can make it very economical compared to frame structures. Frame structures will have lot of complicated analysis. And also we have to worry more about the moment being taken. So sometimes sections are designed very heavily. So let us just try to go through the important features of a truss. So remember that truss consists of long and slender straight members connected at joints. So we call A, B, C, D, as you see here, these are all joints and all the members are connected to the joints. Okay. Now we can simply say that truss is nothing more than assembly of triangles. So if you keep on adding few triangles, so that makes a truss. Okay. But in actual practice, what we see that how the connections are done here. You can see here that there will be a gusset plate, so we call it gusset plate, and all the members are going to come, and then we are going to make it either bolted or riveted. So therefore, a fixity is induced. There is some kind of fixity in this joint. However, during the analysis, we say the members are pinned together. And the reason we do this, because it is much easier to construct this kind of joints than that of actual pin joints. However, pin joints are also seen. You can see how the three members are connected by pin joints. That means they will be able to rotate. That means small rotation is allowed. However, no bending is allowed. No bending, flexural deformation of the member will be allowed at the joint. So they can actually try to rotate about these joints. Now remember, when we say that these members are pin jointed, that means AC is a pin joint, you know, AD, they are jointed by the pins at the two ends, and I don't apply any load, lateral load on the members, then we can clearly say that all these members will be two force members. Okay. So what is two force member? As we have learned that two force members are going to carry equal and opposite load, right? And their line of action has to be same, as if there is only one load going through it, but in order to make the equilibrium possible, we are saying that equal and opposite force with same line of action is there. Okay. So, if this is happening, then if the member is in tension, then we are going to show like this. If the member is under compression, then we are going to show like this. So, remember, as I said before also, the members of a truss are slender and not capable of supporting large lateral loads. That means, in a truss structure, I will never try to put any load on the member laterally. They will simply bend and they can break. Only thing it can do, it can take a large amount of axial load. So, the members are designed for only axial loads. And the loads must be applied at the joints. Again, as we can see, the members are always going to be light in weight and therefore very economical. Now, remember that when we look at bridges, we will see that there are two trusses. Here you can see the two trusses are actually joined together. How they are joined? So, this is kind of bridge deck. That bridge deck, now where the probably if you think of a railway bridge, the train will pass through it. So, you can see, or even it is a foot bridge, then human being is crossing through this bridge. So, what is happening now? This bridge deck can take the lateral load. So, if you look at the arrangements, we are going to have some, you know, longitudinal members. So, these are we call, you know, take the bending, these are called stringers, and these are floor beams. Now, here these members can actually take the lateral load, or rather, you know, out of plane load that is coming from the weight of the body or weight of the vehicle. And these are going to be transferred to the joints of the truss. Okay. Therefore, as we clearly demonstrated, that loads must be applied at the joints in a truss. Now, there are a variety of truss that are being used in civil engineering applications. As you can see here, that all of these truss are actually possible. However, those are given different types of names. Now, depending on the applications, depending on the, you know, person who has discovered this kind of truss first, or even based on, you know, their shapes. So, all of this you can see clearly, they are assemblage of triangles, but it is not necessarily that all the time that a truss has to be an assembly of triangles. Okay. Now, we are going to discuss about how do I define this truss when we are trying to do the analysis. Okay. So, in order to make this kind of truss stable, what would be the necessary condition for us? So, if we look at it carefully, we can clearly see that how I am going to construct a truss. Let us think of this, that I have a triangle, and remember in this triangle I have three members and all members are pin connected. That means, I have a pin connection at A, pin connection at B and pin connection at C. Therefore, all these members are two force members. Now, that is my basic triangular truss. So, if I consider the basic truss, and now what I am going to do, I am simply going to add two members and one connection. That means, two members are extruded and they are connected by a pin at D. Okay. Likewise, I can again extend this, that means, I can extrude two members, let us say D E and C E, and again connected by a pin. So, therefore, I am going to form this kind of trusses as I have demonstrated earlier. Okay. So, you can see now, if that happens, if I can construct a truss using this philosophy, then I can say that I am following a thumb rule, and that thumb rule is M equals to 2n minus 3, where M is the total number of members and N is the number of joints. So, as you can see here, I have in this case 5 members. How many joints I have? I have 4 joints, right? So 2 times 4 minus 3, that's going to give me 5. And I will call this, now this truss will be called a simple truss, as long as this logic is maintained and I can construct this truss. However, remember, as I said before, that it is not necessary that to maintain this logic, I have to always come up with a triangle assembly. For example, in this case, you can see that B, E and D is a basic triangular truss, okay? And from that I am going to extrude 2 members, right? So this part becomes a simple truss, you can see here, right? And here you see that it is, no, still I can do m equals to 2n minus 3 in this case, and I can come up with this kind of structure, this kind of truss. So the idea is I have to still call this is a simple truss, but it is not necessarily made up only of triangles. However, in practice we tend to always maintain the triangular shape. Now what does a simple truss would do? What do I mean by simple truss? Remember, what happens if I have a simple truss, for example, a basic truss like this or this or that, if I support it properly using 3 reactions, so proper 3 reactions are induced in this truss, it will be perfectly stable. It can sustain any amount of load. And also observe that if we construct a truss like this, right, then if we apply any kind of loading which can come from the external load or support reactions, the internal geometry will not change. That means a simple truss is always internally rigid. So what is most important, that if it is a simple truss, it is always internally rigid. So the internal rigidity will always be maintained. That means no angle here would change if you apply the load. The truss internally will not collapse. However, if you look at this truss, okay, now if I really apply a load, what can happen? We can clearly see that there will be tendency that this joint can basically come to here and this will be shifted out. So therefore, this truss can collapse, okay. So a simple truss will be always internally rigid, it will not internally collapse. But if you try to form any other type of truss without this mechanism, we have to be extremely careful, and therefore it can internally collapse. Now how do I analyze a truss? Remember, just going back to it, suppose this is a truss where I have 4 joints and 5 members. So you can see this is simple truss where I have m equals to 2n minus 3, that is number of members must be equals to 2 times joints minus 3. So before we analyze this truss, we have to make sure that what are the supports I have, what kind of supports I have. So here you have a pin connection, so there is a hinge here, and we have a roller or a rocker here. So that means first I identify the support reactions. So as we can see, I have AX and AY, and here we have BY. So these are the 3 support reactions, okay. Now to analyze the truss by method of joints, we will always try to consider the equilibrium of joints. So what will happen if I keep on dismembering the, you know, I want to isolate the members. So therefore, if I isolate it, what we are going to have? We are either going to have a compressive force on it or a tensile force in. Now, as per the Newton's third law, suppose this member is in compression, then on the joint, if I look at the joint A, it is simply going to be transferred back to the joint. So, there will be an opposite force that is going to the joint. So, in the joint, it is going to be inward. So, a compressive force in the member will be inward in the joint. Whereas, if you look at it carefully, we see that a tensile member, that means let us say if it is under tension, the tensile member, the tension force will go as a force in the joint which is outward. So, a compressive force on the joint will be always inward, a tensile force in the joint will be always outward. Okay? And that will tell me that then if I know the nature of the member forces, then I should be able to transmit these forces into the joints. So, likewise, what is happening here, if I keep on dismembering all the members, if I isolate the members and transfer these forces back onto the joints and I look at the joint equilibrium, now how many joint equilibrium I have? So, per joint, remember, I have two equilibrium equations, because at the joint, remember, at the joint, I have concurrent system of forces. You can see here, therefore, there is no moment equations. Only thing that I have, sum of force along x equals to 0 and sum of force along y equals to 0. So, in that way, in this problem, how many joints I have? I have 4 joints, therefore, I have total of 8 equilibrium equations. So, I can create 8 equilibrium equations in this case. So, on the basis of that, if I have 8 equilibrium equations, then I should be able to solve for maximum of 8 unknowns. The question is, do I have 8 unknowns in this problem? The answer is yes, because we can see clearly that I have 5 member forces as unknown. So, 5 unknown forces from the member and I have 3 reactions from the support as unknown. So, total unknowns are actually 8 and I can have 8 equilibrium equations. So, we have to adopt to this logic. So, what it means essentially? For a simple truss, we said that m equals to 2n minus 3. Okay. Now, if that simple truss is supported properly by 3 reactions, that means I will call this as R, reaction equals to R, therefore, m plus R equals to 2n. Okay. So, as long as m plus r equals to 2n, where m is the number of members, r is the number of reactions and n is the number of joints, as long as this is maintained, I can say that the truss is statically determinate. And it is in this problem completely constrained, because the way the reactions are being acting here, that will make the truss absolutely stable. It cannot move in any direction. So, therefore, this truss will be statically determinate and completely constrained. However, remember that this statement right here, m plus r equals to 2n, does not guarantee that the truss will be properly constrained. That means, it can still be an unstable truss. And therefore, in that case, if it is so, I cannot say that it is statically determinate as well, because in that case, what will happen? Basically, all the equilibrium equations will not be satisfied. So, the idea is that when we start solving the problem, I have to ensure to make it at least statically determinate, I have to say m plus r equals to 2n. Now it may be unstable truss. If it is unstable, then equilibrium equations may be violated, and we will see that towards the end of this session. Okay. So for the time being, let us assume that the problem that we are going to target can be solved by the static equilibrium equations, and they are properly constrained. That means I should have m plus r equals to 2n, as well as the reaction should be acting in such a way that the truss will not be able to make any movement in any directions. Okay. Now, to start the analysis, remember one of the way to solve would be I have to show each joint I can choose, and I can start solving the problem by saying sum of force equals to x equals to 0, sum of force along y equals to 0. And it will be always advisable that we start from a joint where I have only two unknowns. For example, in this problem, by taking the global equilibrium, I can solve for the reactions first. So reaction will, let's say, be solved. Then I will be interested in finding out what are the member forces. Okay, and if it is so, then I will just go to this joint right here, let's say. Then I have only two unknowns here, the member forces, and I can solve for these member forces by saying, by taking the equilibrium along the x direction and along the y direction at this joint. Now remember, if you keep doing this, what will ultimately happen, that for each joint I will be able to construct a force polygon, and the force polygon can be drawn. So this will give you an instant visual feedback that how my joint forces should look like. For example, in this case, so it will always give you a closed force, closed force polygon. So the closed force polygon means there is no actually resultant, because resultant vanishes, resultant equals to 0, and that's the equilibrium. So what will happen, you can see here that if I look at this joint particularly, which is being depicted here, we see here that reaction is first solved, and reaction has to be upward. Now if the reaction remains upward and I want to construct a force polygon, in this case closed polygon, then this member has to be under compression such that on the joint it is pointing inward. Okay, so this will be AF, that's the compressive force on the member, and this has to be tensile force on the member, and thereby I have a closed polygon whose resultant is equals to 0. So once we start from this joint, let's say, and I can get an instant visual feedback that yes, this member has to be under compression and this member has to be under tension, we could also do that using the simple sum of force along x equals to 0 and sum of force along y equals to 0. But this is going to be unique, that you have to always construct with these directions. The direction will remain same. I am not saying that you can't do it other way around. It is possible, but that direction cannot be altered. These directions cannot be altered. It can't be taken to the other direction. It has to be always a closed circuit, and to maintain that closed circuit, direction of the forces has to be like this. Similarly, once I solve this joint, then I can immediately move to the next joint, and first I know the AF, so I draw the AF. Now to make a force polygon, I have to say EF this way and BF this way, such that the circuit is closed, the polygon is closed. Okay. So, in this way instantly I will know that what are the members are in tension and what are the members are in compression. We could go to more and more complex joints, you can clearly see that ultimately in all cases if the joint equilibrium is satisfied, we should be able to come up with a force polygon which will look like either a triangle or a polygon. Now, what we are going to study? We are going to study the joints under special loading conditions. Now, to do so, remember in my mind I am always trying to take the joint equilibrium and try to see what relationship exists between various members that are connecting at a joint. So, I could either do sum of force along x equals to 0 or sum of force along y equals to 0. Remember, x and y are always two perpendicular axes and they can be oriented in any manner. It is not always necessary that x will be horizontal and y will be vertical. Just keep that in mind. We can either look at sum of force along x equals to 0 or y equals to 0, or we can take the methodology of the force polygon. Whichever way we like it, we can do it. So, what happens? Force in opposite members intersecting in two straight lines. So, see AE is a member, AC is a member, AD and AB. They are intersecting in two straight lines. What will happen? We can clearly see that AB is equals to AD and AC is equals to AE. Okay. So, that means whenever we have opposite members intersecting at a joint and the joint does not have any additional load, that means external load, then we can always say that forces in the opposite members are equal. Similarly, how about this joint? Now, you have two members which is collinear and then one member is like this. In this member you can see the force is acting which is collinear to this member AC. Now, how do I determine what relationship exists between the member forces or with the load? Now, remember if I take a horizontal equilibrium, then it immediately tells me that AD equals to DB, and if AD is equals to DB, then from the vertical equilibrium I will have AC must be equals to P. That means this member has to be under compression. Okay. Now, how about this one? Now, here no external loads are applied, then immediately what will happen? This member will be equals to 0. So, the force in the third member will be 0 if there is no force acting along that member. Otherwise, that member will simply be equals to the load that is acting along that member. Now, if you come to the next one, forces in two members connected at a joint are equal if the members are aligned. Now, if the members are aligned, I can clearly say that the forces are going to be equal in this member. Okay. Otherwise, they will be 0. That means, in this case, if this is the condition of a joint, I have only two members connecting like this, then both members will go to 0. Now, we are going to take a very simple exercise to see that if I understand the special loading conditions in the joint, then analysis of truss could be very simple. That means, just inspecting various joints, I can immediately get sum of the member forces. So, some member forces can be immediately obtained as long as any of these conditions are met. So, suppose this is a truss, it is a simple truss, as you can see here, load is applied, it has a hinge joint here, it has a roller support here, so two reactions. Now, you can see clearly the members that are marked in green color. So, for example, if I just look at this joint, looking at this joint, I can immediately tell that CB is equals to 0. So, the member force in this member is 0, force in this member is 0. Similarly, if I look at this joint, I can say the member force is going to be 0. Now, what happens at K, if I look at this joint, Kj is 0, then immediately I can jump to joint J. If I go to the joint J, now joint J is under which condition? Now, since Jk is already 0, joint J comes in under this category. You see, now when it is under this category, then if you see, if I take the equilibrium perpendicular to this axis, so that means if I take equilibrium perpendicular to BD, right, then AC has to be 0. So, therefore, in this case, Ji also should be equals to 0. Now, I can't predict any other joints in this case, or in other words, no other joints are actually falling under this category. However, there is a joint that is going to this one. So, since I know Ji, let us say I know Ji already, can I come to I? If I come to I, joint I, then what is happening? Then I see this is under this category. I have two members like this, and third member is aligned with the load. So, third member is aligned with the load, and as we know, therefore, IH must be equals to 20 kilonewton. So, firstly, what we have learned is that it will be simple to understand the zero force member. So, zero force members are BC, IJ and JK, and we can clearly see the zero force members are quickly obtained if this condition is there. Or this condition is there, whereby AC is also equals to 0. So, going by this, I can always say that what are my zero force member in the truss. So, we will take a quick example of zero force member. Let us try to identify what are the zero force member in this truss for the given loading. Can we identify quickly? The answer is yes. How about if I just first try to understand that we have to make sure that we know how the reactions are going to come into play. So, one reaction here will be vertical reaction here and vertical reaction here, there is no horizontal reaction. Okay. So, therefore, now we go to the special conditions. So, I can clearly see to go to the zero force member, if I really go to this member right here, okay, I can clearly say that IE equals to 0. Similarly, once IE is known, let us say, then again I can go to joint T. Now, joint T is under that special condition, where if you take a equilibrium perpendicular to HC, I am going to get EB equals to 0. Okay. So, EB is 0, IE 0. What else is 0 in this case? Okay, how about IJ? Is it a zero force member? The answer is yes. Now, you have a vertical reaction here, right? And if you look at the joint equilibrium here, there is nothing to balance. So, IJ has to be also equals to 0. Similarly, if IJ is equals to 0, then IH is also equals to 0 from joint I. then you go to, let's say, on the other side. Similarly, the logic that we have said, there is a, if you look at the joint equilibrium here of this joint, I have a reaction here. That reaction will be taken by this load right here. Okay. However, there is nothing to balance this force. So therefore, this will also be equals to zero. Okay. Anything else could be zero? Yes. If this is equals to zero, if f g equals to zero, then g h is also equals to zero. Okay. So we can take one more examples of this. So try to identify quickly what are the zero force member. Very immediately we can say L g is zero, N I is zero, C h is zero, E j is zero, D e is zero. So all of these has to be looked at very, very thoroughly and very quickly. Okay. So you can clearly see that all of these joints are falling under those special category, and therefore we can very easily identify the zero force members on a truss. Now, before I get into the method of joints, is there any points to discuss here? Before we go to the detail analysis of a truss that try to find out the member forces, can we have any kind of discussions here?
1139, go ahead for your question.
You have shown that simple truss, sir. And there you are saying that two members are required to form a two members and one joint. But yes, there you have not defined the truss definition.
No.
You have directly given m is equal to
2n minus 3.
M is equal to 2n minus 3.
Yes. So the logic is that now, see, before you even get into the truss, so your question is, why did I call it a simple truss? See, it's a truss. See, truss, yes. So the idea is, see, truss is what? As I said, see, you can, when we are explaining, we can say that truss is just a formation of triangles. If we have triangles on the system, right, I can say, okay, it's a some kind of truss. Remember, I am assuming that all the joints are pin also. That has to be a condition. Now, simple truss, when I'm illustrating, for the simple truss, I am saying that when you think of a basic triangular truss, if I have a just a triangle, you apply any kind of load, it should not be internally deformed. First, I make sure that the body that I have chosen is properly rigid. If I can't say the body is rigid, then I cannot say that that's a good truss, that's a stable truss. Because internally, if the it is collapsing, then there is no point of discussion. So to define a proper internally rigid truss, we came to the definition of a simple truss. Okay. Now, simple truss, that's a thumb rule that m is equals to 2n minus 3, because you are always extruding from the two members from the joints and connecting it by a another pin connection. Okay. So, m equals to 2n minus 3, that logic is always being maintained. However, it was not necessary that it will always form the triangles. I have also shown an example that by m equals to 2n minus 3, it is not going to be proper triangle. But remember that if I follow that logic, it is always going to be internally rigid. That means no matter how I apply the load, the internal angle will not change. That's the rigid body concept, and then we can solve for the forces, external forces, right? Okay. So internal rigidity is being maintained in a simple truss. Now, to make the entire truss to be stable, then we have to see that what kind of support reactions are necessary. Okay. Now, if you support a simple truss by three reactions, then it is fine. Okay.
I want to add one sentence. To form a truss, three basic bars are required and three joints are required.
That's the basic triangular truss. Okay. You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right. I need minimum, I need 3 members and 3 joints.
1103.
Sir, the problem that we just discussed, in that we were finding, the zero force members, sir. If you look into the half part of it, yesterday we had a problem that was solved by Mandar Inanda, sir. In that case, he had particularly considered a particular beam to be zero force member. Whereas in this case, we are not doing the same. So the last problem that we just saw, that we were considering the zero force members. Sir, the link DE that we have, DB that we have, in that case, it was yesterday we had the same configuration, but it was horizontal. This is a vertical configuration. We had a horizontal configuration back then. So I would just like to know, how do we decide upon a particular member being a zero force member and not being a zero force member under loading conditions, similar loading conditions?
So let me understand your problem, question clearly. So because the last problem means you are talking about the one now in the slide, right? The problem one, this one.
So the upper one.
Yes. Because your voice is breaking, just now go ahead. The question was, why it's a zero force member, i.e.
So the problem is that why, if BE is a zero force member, why not BD is a zero force member in this case?
So now your question was, why BE is a zero force member but not BD? Okay, remember, all of the time I am looking at a joint equilibrium. So what I am saying here, that if I consider a joint and these member forces are transmitting the force into the joint, that's the first part. Now I am simply considering this joint has to be in equilibrium, right? Now I have already proved in this, from this side, that IE is equals to 0. Okay? Now if IE is equals to 0, then if I come to this joint, just think of this joint now has this force and this force. So EH, EC and EB. Okay? Now EH and EC, they are equal to each other. Just think of taking an equilibrium along the EC axis. Now if this is so, then EC must be equals to EH. But if I take a equilibrium perpendicular to this line of EH and EC, then what happens? Then there is nothing to balance, no force there is to balance for EB. So that means that is equals to 0. Come with the same logic this side. What happens now? I have to start from joint G. First of all, is it clear why EB is equals to 0? Did you follow me?
Yes.
Now,
yes, sir.
Let us come to this side. I am starting from joint G. Can you please tell what is the force in GD?
It will be equal to P.
Yes, absolutely great. So now, if this force is equals to P, remember in this case it was 0, now this is P, right? Now you think of same way, that means what happens if I take a vertical equilibrium about this line H? If I consider H and I try to take a perpendicular equilibrium, what that would give me? That would give me now a relationship between BD and P. Therefore, BD cannot be equals to 0. Is that clear now? So it's all about equilibrium about any two axes. That is what we are doing. Because remember, now joint is simply a particle, and on that particle I am applying concurrent system of forces, because all the member forces are coming and meeting to this joint. It becomes a concurrent force system, okay? And the resultant has to be 0. That means what? sum of force along x equals to 0, sum of force along y equals to 0. All I am saying that x, y can be any two perpendicular axes, need not to be horizontal and vertical. Therefore, since you have said that dg is equals to p, if I really consider an equilibrium perpendicular to ah, right, then you can see that dB of some angle must be equals to P of some angle. So, therefore, dB is not non-zero. Is that clear now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh. 1131.
In problem 1, the full bottom core member appears to be in zero force. In practical, how will it be possible that the full member FJ will not have any force, neither tension nor compression?
So, your question is that there are so many members, let us say there are so many members that are going to 0, right. So, let us say I have, you know, in the bottom cord of that truss, bottom members all are 0. How is that possible? See, we do not think like this, that is a special condition of a loading. For a given loading, the member forces are going to 0, but in a practical scenario, when we are designing it, we have to design it based on all possible combinations of loading, right. So, all possible combinations of loading will not lead to 0 force. So, it depends on, I may get some forces to be 0 for a given condition of loading, given set of external loading, but it may not be 0 all the time. Is that clear now? Okay, so, for a particular loading it is just 0, but it is not necessary that they will be always 0, depends on the loading condition.
Still, the force P acts at G downwards, it will pull the joint D downwards, the joint D will pull B and A downwards, and hence ABC will come in compression, and hence FHIJ will go in tension, that is what I feel.
No, fine, no, whatever it goes, that is a different issue, which member will be in which compression and tension, it is fine. But see, remember your truss is a simple truss, it is properly supported by the reactions properly, it is a properly constrained and stable truss. That means, no matter whatever tension compression coming into play, it is fine, but the truss will not deform, truss cannot deform, it is being a rigid body, internally rigid. Now, there are actual deformation that will take of course place, but what I am trying to say, actual deformation is what we study in the, you know, when we go to the next level of course on structural analysis, there we will study the actual deformation. But in this case, engineering mechanics, rigid body concept is intact. That means the truss can as a whole move, that means as a whole it can translate or as a whole it can rotate. That is the rigid body. But I cannot say that individual parts are actually, you know, doing the tension and compression. That means individual parts are actually deforming in such a way that entire truss will collapse. I cannot say that. Okay, so that is the whole point of saying, and we will come to that in this session itself towards the end, when it is not going to be stable and when it is going to be stable internally even. Okay.
One more doubt, in the initial slides of internally rigid trusses,
which one,
the simple trusses 1D,
yeah, yes,
I think third, fourth slide it might be,
yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
That figure. Yeah. In that figure, we have shown one force acting at B dash.
B is the force actually applied on the structure. This is the force being applied. Now, consequence is that, see, that brings in the concept of why a simple truss is rigid and why other truss is not rigid. Okay, this is not a simple truss, first of all. This is not a simple truss, because it does not start from a basic truss, triangular truss. Look at the concept of simple truss here. First, I must identify a basic triangular truss. That means that has to be formed by three members and three pins. Then I start doing this operation. Now here that is not maintained first of all, and the consequence is very, very simple. If you apply a load, every joint is a pin, what will happen? This joint can rotate, this joint can rotate. There is no member that this joint will transfer the force to member. To make it simple truss, I needed a member BD. I repeat, to make it a simple truss, I need a member BD. If I don't have BD, consequence is severe, the truss will collapse, because there is no load to support this externally applied load. You can see now, just from the intuition, this joint will try to move this way because there is a pin here, it will try to adjust themselves. So this will simply undergo rigid body rotation, this is also coming down, it can deform into different shape depending on to what kind of load you are applying. But in this truss, if you apply a load, it's not going to deform in any manner like the way it is shown. So internally this is rigid. You are, see, there is a small deformation. That deformation is not what we are talking about. That deformation is always present, that comes in strength of materials. When we solve for the forces, remember that deformation does not do anything unless otherwise it's a very, very large deformation. Okay, because engineering mechanics, we started with a rigid body concept based on the fact that the body can only translate and rotate. For example, if you have a beam, right, a beam, you apply a load, of course there is a deformation, that's a bending deformation to the beam. But when we are solving the forces, where is that bending? We are not taking into account, right? So here problem is very different. First we proved that this entire truss itself is an internally rigid truss. It cannot change any angle, means it will not collapse under the action of load. It will not collapse. The word collapse is used, okay? In this case, it will collapse. It can't sustain. How can it sustain this load? Okay, so simple truss is always internally rigid, and this is not internally rigid because you have pins, na? They are able to rotate itself. Okay, so there is an actual deformation. That actual deformation is the next study, but there is a real deformation. The real deformation, if it takes place, real means that is a rigid body deformation. That means we are really going to hear the collapse stage. Okay. Yes.
Sir, we preferably go for the perfect frames always. Means it is satisfying the condition M is equal to 2N minus 3. Sometime we may need to go for redundant frames also. So how to ensure, how to think?
So now I got your question. So you are saying, now first of all, this is a truss. Okay, I am not talking about frame here. Your question is, what is a redundant frame? Redundant is simply statically indeterminacy. Even you can think in terms of truss perspective. Suppose due to severe load, one member fails, right? Then the truss become unstable. If I make it perfectly statically determinate, then if one member fails, then the truss cannot sustain the load. It will collapse. So what we do? We add few extra members. That will make it indeterminate. So that will be the redundant members. So we prefer to always make truss redundant. You are absolutely correct. We always prefer to make a truss with lot of indeterminacy, because if one member fails, at least the truss will not collapse. Okay, clear? But we are not going to solve indeterminate problem, and that will bring in the essence of what your colleague was telling before. When we want to solve indeterminate problem, we have to look at the kinematics, actual deformation of the truss. Okay, then actual deformation will come into play, and that will couple to solve for the extra unknown forces. Okay, that is in structural analysis.
Sir, in practice, whether we shall prefer the redundant frames then?
It is always desired in case of a truss. It is desired, we tend to do it, but it is all depends on the designer. In practice, you will always try to decide on a redundant frame. And in fact, there are a lot of research how to make a building redundant, you know, more redundancy, but you have to minimize the redundancy also. It is not that you want to make it extremely redundant, because your economy comes into play also. Okay.
1279, go ahead for your question.
Yes, sir. What is the age of zero force member in a truss? Why we incorporate zero force members in the truss?
Your question is, why do we incorporate zero force member on truss? My answer is, we do not incorporate zero force member. It's a consequence of the external loading. As a designer, I will always try to make different kind of loading conditions. For that loading conditions, I design the truss. Now, I have given a problem in such a way that some members are becoming zero due to that loading. It is not the incorporation of zero force member. But if I apply some other loading onto the truss, they will not be zero. No, they will not be zero. Okay?
Is there any criteria on the number of zero force members?
No. There is nothing like zero force member incorporation. It is a process depending on how you apply the load in the structure. Okay?